First, let's pay homage to the lineage gurus, to the Venerable Monk Liaoming. Wholeheartedly, we pay homage to the Venerable Monk Liaoming. Wholeheartedly, we pay homage to Master Sakya Dzogchen. Wholeheartedly, we pay homage to the 16 Dharma King Karmapa. And wholeheartedly, we pay homage to Master Dzogchen Dorje. Homage to the three jewels of the altar. And homage to the main deity of Homa, the wealth attracting goddess, or hooking, the goddess who continually hook on money and beauty. Simu, all Dharma masters, Dharma educators, Dharma teachers, Dharma lecturers, Dharma assistants, temple directors, all disciples present here and over the internet, and our special guest today from Republic of Taiwan, Minister of Foreign Affairs, North American Coordination Council, Secretary General Daniel Liao's wife, Dharma Sister Judy. Accountant of the Tripura Foundation, Dharma Sister Teresa and her husband Larry. Producer for the Guinea Diansang Xinten, Dharma Sister Rebecca Shiachi. And Dr. Hong Xinjia. And Dr. Ryan Zhuang. And Dr. Gao. Good afternoon, how do you do?
大家午安, 大家好.
That was in Taiwanese, in Mandarin,
你好,
in Cantonese. And thank you, everybody.
Thank you for coming. See you next week. See you soon.
So today, we perform the Homa of the Wealth Attracting Goddess, and her look is like this statue in painted colors. Her right hand is holding the Vajra hook, and her left hand is holding the treasure mouse. And she is red, wearing beautiful crown, and in Tibet, she is 16-year-old girl as the wealth-attracting goddess. And for us, you need to be 18 to be adult. But in Tibet and India, the girls mature earlier. So 16 is the perfect age for a lady. But here, you need to be 18 to be adult. It's very easy to visualize. That's how she looks, how you would visualize her. And the mudra is the Vajra hook mudra. That's this Vajra hook, because she's holding the Vajra hook, is to hook the wealth.
Om Mazo Hazya is Mazo Hazya.
The mantra, Maruharya.
他的名字就是
Her name is Maro Haraya. The mantra and the inkusa inkusa xie 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 hom 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 pei so ha means that all the celestial wealth and resources are bestowed upon spiritual cultivators. The meaning of the mantra. That's the meaning of the mantra. And the seed syllable is tri. And that's the seed syllable of Amitabha Buddha. And in Tibetan, it's also pronounced shit. Shit or ri. And in Japanese or Sanskrit is three, shit or three, different pronunciations, but the same seed syllable, the same meaning. It's the seed syllable of Amitabha Buddha. So this wealth attracting goddess is the greatest wealth deity of Western paradise. And the reason was because she was emanated from the heart of Amitabha Buddha. Amitabha Buddha has two attendants, close attendants. One is Guan Yin, Lokeswara Bodhisattva, and the other one is Mahastama Prapta Bodhisattva as his attendants. But this wealth attracting goddess was emanated by Amitabha Buddha. So we call her the third party or the mistress goddess. So this mistress is only 16 years old. She followed Amitabha Buddha to all the Western paradises, to all the pure lands. She traveled to all the pure lands. And then she used her hook all the best parts of those pure lands onto the Western paradise. That's why the Western paradise, the pure land of Amitabha Buddha, is the best, the most perfect, the most marvelous pure land. So this Mahaharaya, the wealth attracting goddess, like the mountain god is also a wealth deity from the earth, and the dragon god is the wealth deity of the ocean. And in heavens, the four heavenly kings are also wealth deities, very rich. But in the pure land, in the highest realm, the highest wealth deity is this wealth attracting goddess, Maro Haraya. So one time when we perform this goddess Homa, I bestowed empowerment. And after the empowerments, I said that someone will win a lottery prize. And till now, nobody ever reported that he or she won a lottery. So maybe it's best not to tell people when you win a lottery, otherwise you would be in trouble. Because in Tubuddha school, the one who won the first prize in lottery were two people. One person is the one that doesn't dare to come to our temple anymore, and the other one is still here, still coming. Because the first one was made public by the media, so he doesn't dare to come anymore. And the second one, nobody knows that this person won the lottery. So after the empowerment that day, someone also won a lottery. Of course, it's not just $10 or $1,000. But he won. So they're above, they're six digits or more, or even more. So definitely above six digits. But this person did not tell. So it is best not to make it public. Otherwise, there are many masters and reference who are very aggressive, who would find you and ask for donations. So it's best not to tell. But Grandmaster knows, and I will not tell. Someone did win the lottery. So, Maruharaya used her Vajra hook to hook on this wealth. If you want gold, wow, so many golds falling down. It's like tons of them. The golds that were hooked were tons, like more than a ton. But please don't be greedy, otherwise you would be hit by the gold bars. Let the gold fall in front of you instead. In the past, when I visualized Franklin dollar bills, the US dollar bills, I went to a bank and I checked on the geomancy on the land of a bank. And it was closing time. They take down the bars, the iron gate, and they were counting monies. And I saw, because I was checking on the geomancy for them, it was something like a board. And they placed the bills there. It was heap. It was huge. Huge. It's like a little mountain, little hill of dollar bills at the center of the bank. So it left a vivid impression on me after I saw that, the Franklin pile up high. And when I used the Vajra hook, it would fall down like that was in the bank. It was all mine. They were all mine. I couldn't lift it. I couldn't carry it. So I placed it inside a bag, or plastic bags, like the black garbage bags. A dozens of bags will not be enough to carry them all. And the money was very heavy too. So $3 million. And you just lift it with your hand. Say if you place $3 million inside the bag, And because papers are heavy, so papers and gold are heavy. What is the heaviest thing is gold. 1 kilogram of gold is quite heavy. It felt, it feels very heavy. And $3 million bills is not enough in a briefcase. It needs a Dr. Blue a briefcase that's with two hands, one hand 3 million and the other hand 3 million. That's why we often recite this mantra. Om Mani Padme Hum sounds like Om Mani coming home. It's not Om Mani coming home. It's like water coming. Taiwanese would say like earning money is the same as getting water. There's this joke. And spending money is like defecating, but earning money is like eating the stool. So it's easy for the rich people to earn money, like Bill Gates, like the rich man of Taiwan, Ge Taiming. And the rich man of Hong Kong, Li Kai-sing, it's easy for them to earn money because they already have lots of money. And to use that money to earn more money, that would be easy for them. Now when I lift up my head and watch TV, they always talk about Fu Si Kang. It's the group in Taiwan, and they also talk about Apple 6, iPhone 6. So you always change when they have new versions 6, 7, 8, and they keep earning money. Do you have Apple 4 or Apple 3 or Apple 2 or Apple 1? Then you can give that to Sky Master. I don't need Apple 6. That intelligent cell phones, I don't know. Do you have Apple 1? It's gone, it's obsolete. Well, just give it to me. Because Grandmaster doesn't have any. I only have two cell phones that are really old style. They can only be used to make phone call. There's no Wi-Fi or any reception, other reception. So I am really obsolete. And my mindset is quite old. But this wealth-attracting goddess is not just to catch money, but also for love and respect. Among all the offerings earlier, there was a plate that's filled with red stuff for love and harmony. This vajra hook can hook on anything you want. So the vajra hook can extend really long, all the way to Southeast Asia, to Africa, to Australia, to North Pole, South Pole, anywhere, to China, to Russia. The vajra hook can extend very long. Wherever you find a beautiful lady, you can hook on her. It is effective. It really is effective. And that's just the guideline, and you can be creative. So you can even invoke the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas using this Vajra hook. So when you invoke Buddhas and Bodhisattvas, you use this mudra. And the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas are on the clouds in the sky. And when you use this hook, you hook on the clouds. And the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas also fall down with it. Amitabha Buddha, the world-attracting goddess, and many other Buddhas, Bodhisattvas, they all descend upon us here. So here, we got the blessings of all these deities. So, when you make use this Maruhareya's Dharma practice, and you use the Vajra hook to hook on whatever you wish for, and that becomes one of the transcendent prowess, which is getting whatever you wish for. Whatever you wish for, it happens. We always wish people that may all your wishes come true. So you generate your transcendent power, you use the Vajra hook, and then whatever you wish for is fulfilled. She has such great power. That's the end of the introduction for Maruhareya. So with the mudra, mantra, and her that would comprise the deity yoga for Maruhareya. So in tantric cultivation, we use this. So you gradually gain spiritual response with Maruhareya. Once you gain spiritual response, all your wishes come true, all of them. Even when you have a bad disaster, you use the Vajra hook to hook it away, to throw it away. You use the hook to hook it and then throw it really, really far away to the North Pole. And then it got frozen there. You use the Vajra hook to hook it, the bad stuff, and throw it all the way to West Africa to catch Ebola. And then he or she would be bedridden there. So this Maruhareya deity is very important deity. You can hook on the good things and then hook out and throw out the bad things. If you gain spiritual response, all your wishes come true. Now let's continue on the Great Perfection Dharma. Yesterday, I was talking about the one and only marvelous wisdom and its mystic profundity, and no doing and no manipulation are inherently Buddhahood. These two phrases are the secret of all Great Perfection Dharma. No doing and no action, no manipulation are inherently Buddhahood. And the next two phrases, the name is the Great Madhyamaka Path. So this is what it is called, the Great Middle Path. So what is this middle view, the middle view of Madhyamaka? Some people say that Siyata Lechang Temple was built with great meanings, and at that time we didn't know. But someone that knew feng shui and also studied Buddhism said that on the right side there is a There's a slope, and then on the left side there's another slope, and then at the center there are stairs. So here is right path, and then here is left path, and at the center is the middle path. So inadvertently, Siadlingtang Temple has right path, left path, and the middle path. And as you climb up the stairs, immediately you reach at the Great Hall, and you have attainment, the place of Siddhi. And for the right path, you curve around, so there's a longer distance, and the left path is also a little bit longer distance. But no matter which path, you can enter into the Great Hall. So all roads lead to Rome, but the great middle view path is that stairs in at the center toward the Siadlingtang Temple, the Great Hall. So that's the Madhyamaka path, which means you're not biased toward the right or the left. You are at the middle. Everything on earth is the middle view, believe it. Your bodies, are in the middle view. As you age, you need to pay attention to your cholesterol, blood sugar, and triglycerides, the three highs. When they're high, then you are too much to the right. And if they are too low, you're too much to the left. If your blood sugar is between 80 and 110, then you're on the middle path. And if your blood pressure is 120 over 80, then you're on the middle path. And the triglyceride, what is the range for that? So if you're within the normal range, then you are on the middle path. That's the theory, the concept. So in our Buddhist studies, we shouldn't go over too much to the right or to the left. We should be in the middle path. When you play guitar, Grandmaster doesn't know, but I have learned until my fingers are all swollen and I stop learning playing guitar. We have a Lucy Dharma sister. Now she's gone to around Toronto for college. She played guitar really well and sang. So she knows, prior to playing the guitar, the strings cannot be too loose, then it will not give sound. But if the strings are too tight, then the sound also not good. The strings have to be just right. Also, the masters who tune the piano also knows. They have to be just right. Only then it would produce beautiful sound. So that's the simple explanation for the middle path. That's on the surface. Actually, it's not that simple. So not only superficial, but also for the inner mind. There are two masters in Japan, Neichen and Gobudaishi, during the Tang Dynasty. A Japanese monk, many Japanese monks and scholars went to the Tang Dynasty to learn. So there were two monks, Dzogchen and Kukai. And Kukai arrived at the Qinglong Temple to meet the old monk Hui Guo to learn the tantric Buddhism of Tang Dynasty. So, Bukong, the three pioneers, Vajrabodhi, the three pioneers, and finally transmitted all the way to this Hui Guo, and Kukai learned from Hui Guo in the Tang Dynasty and returned back to Japan and founded the Shingon Buddhism. And the other monk only got to Mount Tiantai. I know that Mount Wutai is in Shanxi, but Mount Tiantai, nobody knows. Nobody knows about geography. He got to Mount Tiantai, which was closer, and learned about the Tiantai school, Faxiang school, and the small and big, so six schools. And that was the monk Dzogchen, which is the great master Chuanjiao. They checked that Mount Tiantai was in Zhejiang, province Zhejiang. They're incredible. They just stuck and immediately they got the information. I cannot do that. I have to rely on you to get those information so fast. So he got to Zhejiang province, which was closer. So these two monks learned different things. At the Mount Tiantai, there was also tantric Buddhism there. There was the Tang Tantrayana, and from Mount Tiantai is called Thai Tantrayana, and in Japan it's called Japanese Tantrayana and Tibetan Tantrayana. And then Taiwanese, that would be the local Tantrayana. So Tantrayana, local to Taiwan. So the great Madhyamaka. One day, spontaneously, when I used the picture of my husband and kid as the home screen, you know, Simu's computer, the home screen is for Qing and Simu. The picture of the two of them. So I was out. Fo Qi and I were out of scope. So the picture taken at the Jiuzhaigou in China. So the photo was the home screen of Simu and Fo Qing. And I checked if I was anywhere, but no, I wasn't there. And Fo Qi, I wasn't there. So that's why the hearts of mother and daughter are connected. So inside the heart of Simu, there's only Fo Qing. So the wife used the photo of the husband and the son. And the son asked, why, Mom, use my picture as the home screen? And then she said, because I always hold the cell phone on my, in the palm of my hand, so you're like the precious jewel on my palm. And the husband was very pleased, because in the photo there's also me, so am I also the pole inside your heart? And the wife glared sideways and said, "You think too much. What I like to tell you is you would never run away from my, the palm of my hand." So there is a difference. So fortunately, I was not inside her, her sight. So when she opened her computer, all she could see is Fo Qing and me. I wasn't there. I already ran really far. So the great Madhyamaka, the middle view, is direct pointing. So direct pointing to the heart of Buddhism. That's the Madhyamaka. So Tantrayana is considered the middle view. In India, Buddhism are only, there are now only two sects in India, Madhyamaka and Yogacara. And Madhyamaka means that the heart of Buddhism is in the Madhyamaka, which means it's in the great perfection Dharma. So if you are captured inside the palm of your wife, you're pitiful. The husband told the wife, "Well, let me tap on your back," and the wife said, "No, no need." And the husband said, "Let me give you a basin of water for your feet." And the wife replied, "No." And then the husband said, "Let me help you with some housework." And the wife said, "No." And the wife continued, "Well, don't do anything. You just continue to kneel there until the next morning." So such a pity for the husbands that are inside the palm of the wives. Is truly pitiful. There was this joke. Now, when a man is proposing to a woman, he would hold a flower and kneel and ask, "Can you marry me?" So with the flower kneeling, and the son asked the mom, "So when dad proposed to you, did he kneel also?" And the mom said, "No." "Why not? Nowadays, a man would kneel when he proposes." And the mom replied, "Oh, there's no need, because there would be many, many chances for him to kneel after the marriage." Someone said that my life was, I'm still alive due to my wife. At that time we were swimming, and only the two of us in the swimming pool. Only, although the water is only as high as I am, but I was still drowning. When I was about to die and running out of air, my girlfriend climbed out of the swimming pool and the water dropped to my neck. So the wife must be huge. Look at 师母.
师母她这个身材啊,
师母's figure is really nice. Whatever she wears is really beautiful. She has a good line, good figure.
Oh, 她自己讲她是被我虐待到营养不良.
And she said that she's being abused until she is so skinny. If I'm capable to do that, I would be really happy. So, typically, at 师母's age, there would be a hulu, a gourd, the shape of a gourd. And that's good enough because they're still waste. It's worse if you're like a peach shape. Like Master Hui Jun. Let me tell this joke. So Hui Jun, Master Hui Jun and 师母 were about to leave the house, and they were wearing shoes. So they were wearing shoes like this, and then Master Hui Jun's butts hit 师母, and then 师母 flew to the wall. And then fell off the wall. Like a lizard. And then afterwards, 师母 always said, why don't you wear your shoes first and then get out? Master Hui Jun, if you are watching on the internet, you get one more blessing. Being fat is really not. You should have a body figure like 师母. That would be good. So A and B are having a dialogue. How was your marriage arrangement, like the date yesterday? No, it didn't happen. Oh, what? Well, because she's too fat. And you yourself are fat. Why do you despise others? Because I'm fat, I don't want another fat partner. Why? Because then I feel like I'm not finding a partner, but like a sumo opponent. The sumo fighter of Japan is like this. And they walk like this. And with the two legs, and that's how sumo is. So this joke was talking about our heart. So the middle view, the Madhyamaka, is talking about the heart of Buddhism. And it should be spoken to the public by the great perfection Dharma teacher. The name is the Great Madhyamaka Path and should be expounded to the public in the future. In my book, The Highest Yoga Tantra and the Mahamudra, on chapter 26, I wrote an article entitled Vajrapani Mantra Dharma Practice. In the beginning, I wrote, in this article, there are many key divine inspirations of providence. Anyone who understands has the affinity. If one doesn't get it, then one does not have the affinity. In this article, there are hidden many mystic secrets. They are the greatest secrets of all tantric secrets. So the key divine providence is the great perfection Dharma. Anyone able to grasp and practice them is truly fortunate. So the great perfection Dharma is like the Zen Buddhism of China. Originally, in early India, there was also the Zen practices, but they were not called Zen. That was Mahakashyapa. When Sakyamuni Buddha picked a flower and smiled. After he gave Dharma teaching, all of a sudden he picked a flower. And the audience did not understand, could not understand why Sakyamuni Buddha was like that, picking a flower and not speaking. And among the audience, only Mahakashyapa, who was one of the 10 great disciples of Sakyamuni Buddha, he smiled. As Sakyamuni Buddha said, I had the marvelous heart and the true words and the Dharma store of Nirvana transmitted to Mahakashyapa. So Mahakashyapa was the second patriarch, and then it was transmitted all the way to Bodhidharma, the 28th patriarch. And then Bodhidharma went to the China dynasty, to one of the dynasty. Bodhidharma went to China and met with the Emperor Wu of Liang. But they did not connect, so he went to the Northern Wei dynasty and went to Shaolin Temple. And retreated, facing the wall in seclusion for 9 years. And then later on, he transmitted the lineage to the second patriarch, Hui Ke, second patriarch of China, called Hui Ke, the third patriarch called Sun Chan. And then all the way to Hui Neng. And only then it started to be called Zen Buddhism. So in China, after it was transmitted to China, it became widespread and popular. So Great Perfection Dharma has similarity to Zen Buddhism. So the outer practices are like Tantrayana, but the inner practices are like Zen Buddhism. And the most important method of Zen Buddhism is the hidden key divine providence. And the hidden greatest secrets of all tantric secrets. Another joke. One day, Jesus Christ brought his 36 disciples to the bottom of the hill and asked them to take two rocks and then let's climb the hill together. And one of them was Satan, and Satan was actually a demon. So they took the smallest rock because they are about to climb the mountain, because the bigger rocks are heavier. And after they got to the top of the mountain, Jesus said, "So now you can exchange your stones or rocks with the buns, the bread." So Satan got the smallest piece of buns or bread. So he felt upset because he got the smallest piece of buns. So he was still hungry. And the second day, Jesus took them back down the mountain and then asked them to bring two more rocks. And this time, Satan took the biggest rocks he could carry and climbed up the hill. And then after they got to the top, Jesus told them, "Now, whoever could throw the rocks furthest would get the biggest bread, biggest bun." But Satan already got really tired carrying the rocks. How could he throw the rocks far enough? So of course he got a really tiny piece of buns. On the third day, Jesus told them the same thing. Brought the stones climbing up the hill again. So Satan thought, the big rocks can change for the big buns and the small rocks can be thrown far away. So he brought one hand a big rock and the other hand a small rock. And he thought he must be right this time. And they climb and climb up the mountain. And then at the top, Jesus said, "Now you suffered enough climbing up this mountains. To thank you, so I would change those two rocks to become the two balls on your body." So Satan, I cannot say that one of his balls is big and one of his balls is small. They should be equal. But actually, they are one is bigger than the other or smaller than the other, but not such a huge difference. Why don't you check your own? And then one is higher, one is lower, slightly. And one is bigger, one is smaller. Because if they are exactly on the same level, then they would hit each other. You know, in our body, everything is slightly bigger and smaller. Our eyes, one bigger, one smaller. Both of our eyes are not the same, unless you have plastic surgery on them. And your right hand, if you're right-handed, your right hand would be stronger. And in America, of course, there are left-handed people. So one is stronger than the other. If you cut your body halfway, one face is smiling, the other half of the face is the crying. One is the good and the other one is the evil. So everything is half-half. So half of your body, one is stronger, one is weaker. Your legs, your hands, your eyes. One has a stronger eyesight and the other one weaker eyesight. They are always different. The same with your ears. One has a better hearing than the other. They are always half-half. That's how a human being is. And Zen, none of those exists in Zen. What is Zen? When none of those exists, that's called Zen. So think about it. The mystic profundity, the greatest secret of Buddhism, and the so-called Buddha nature of Buddhism was the example I gave earlier. There isn't anything, the so-called big or small, bigger or smaller. And this is the great Madhyamaka path, the mystic profundity, the greatest divine providence, the Zen, and that's the greatest divine mystic of great perfection Dharma. The way I say it this way, many people, maybe most of you wouldn't understand. But you need to ponder on them. Let me tell you another story. It's rather long. After you listen, you would know. There is a doctor that got a phone call for an emergency operation. And he immediately went to the hospital and changed his outfit. And the mother shouted, "How come you're so late? You have no responsibility. Don't you know that my son is in emergency?" And the doctor said, "Sorry, I was in the hospital. I hurried here as fast as I could. Please calm down." And the dad of the son, "Calm. If on the sick bed was your son, could you be calm? If your son is dead, how would you be?" So the father was really angry, but the doctor said, "I would recite Amitabha Buddha. We came from dust and returned to the dust. Please pray for your son." But the dad was still really angry. When you're so apathetic toward people's life and death, that's what you would say. But a few hours later, the surgery went really well, and the doctor was very pleased and told the father, "Thank God, thank heaven and earth that your son was saved." And before the dad replied, he left, "If you have any questions, ask the nurse." But the dad was still really angry. What an arrogant doctor. He couldn't wait for a few minutes to answer my questions and shouted to the nurse. And then the nurse cried and told him that his son died in a car accident yesterday. And when we call on him to work on your son, he was on the way to the funeral. Now, after he saved your son, he had to go to finish his son's funeral. So think about it. So when you're in a hurry, don't blame other people so easily. Because who knows, maybe other people have their own issues. So please never blame other people, because other people may have even a more emergency issues. So what happens in their lives? What kind of problems and challenges they encounter, you may not know. What you see are only the surface. Don't blame others so easily, because we don't have the wisdom in our life to understand all the emotions, to truly sympathetic toward all the different experiences of their lives. So as a Buddhist, we need to understand that this story is educational, that we as Buddhists never blame others so easily and don't scold or curse on others. Please don't create speech karma. So although you're in emergency, but other people may be in a worse emergency. So you should not be so adamant toward others. So see, his son, the doctor's son, has died, but in such situation, he still hurried back to help other people's son with a very peace of mind, in a peace of mind, and still calmly perform the surgery or operation. So sometimes, please don't blame others, because sometimes your accusations may be totally wrong. So when you truly understand the divine providence and also the mystic profundity, the secret of the great perfection Dharma, then you will not be held bondage by afflictions, and you will not blame others, you will not insult others, and you will not also defame others or accuse others. Om Mani Padme Hum.